I get a big kick out of playing the opposite type of character in Oscar.
Listen, it's fun to be a grouch.
And it really is actually fun to be a grouch. I've at first had no idea how to play this character when Henson proposed it back in 69, and I was rather scared. I had just joined Muppets, and I didn't have any deep bass voice to come up with, but a taxi cab driver said,
"Where to, Mac?"
And that was on the way to the rehearsal, and it was just in time. And since I've gotten then, I have gotten to play Oscar, and Oscar is, to me, I've not always a likable character. He's a bit of my alter ego, and he's easy to play because I know what his taste is. It's generally the opposite of what I feel and what I believe, and I don't like messes and trash. And as a matter of fact, at times I wondered that I could even do a decent job, because for early years, I always felt that I wouldn't walk across the street to speak to this character, and why anybody would bother is beyond me.
Well, I think as many of us who work on the show as you would ask that question to, what barriers did Sesame Street break, you'd get as many different answers. My own answers relate to the very beginning of Sesame Street, when it first went on the air. It broke two very important barriers. One was there was a cast of four, and two of the four were black. This was in 1969. We very, very much take for granted the black shows on television now. But at that time, there were none. It was a really revolutionary concept to turn on your television show and see a cast that was heavily integrated to the point where half them were black and half white. The second thing was the departure from the traditional children's show setting. Every children's show, really, ever, always was a cute little treehouse or a club in the backyard or Captain Kangaroo's treasure house. It was always something fairyland and fanciful and wonderful. We had struggled with the idea of the setting, the home base for this, for a long time. And when it came into focus for me, and I saw a commercial for the Urban Coalition, I believe it was Urban Coalition, about send your kid to a ghetto this summer. And it was shot on location in Harlem, out on the sidewalk, on the front stoops of the brownstone. And as soon as I saw it, I knew exactly where we ought to be on this. Because to the three-year-old who's cooped up in the room upstairs, the action is on the street. That's where the big kids are. That's where they're playing. They're jumping rope. They're running up and down, and that noise and everything else. And so what I wanted was not just an exterior of a brownstone in an urban, rundown neighborhood, but I wanted a totally realistic set, not a television set, not canvas on flats that would blow when you turned the air conditioning on and you'd see it was fake. This is a movie set. It might as well be shot on location. It is so solid. In fact, when we first did the brownstone, we built the front steps out of wood because it was cheaper and the normal way to do it. And when people ran up and down, you'd hear their heels hitting the wood and you'd say, no, that doesn't sound right. And we had the steps cast in concrete. The stagehands love us for it every time they have to load them in and out. And they're heavy as can be, but the sound is right. It's a real street and a real building. And to the millions of children who watch, it's a real neighborhood. When they come to visit the studio, they can't believe that Sesame Street is inside another building.
Okay, so this is Dominique, and she is Alphabet Bates' driver. She's also a lavender two-hand puppet. And I'm going to take their eyes off and make her into another character. This is our eye bank. There's lots of different characters, so eyes in here. And the noses are over here. So Nobel Price has these kind of eyes. And it's all just double face tape inside, and we just stick them right on. Okay, I should start with his nose. It's very, very carefully pinned so it stays on. I'll just pin it like that. Now usually there's three or four pins. And then this wig comes off. It's sort of like playing Mr. Potato Head, like when you were a kid, you know? He gets these eyes. Oops. So he's about like that now. He gets glasses. We have a whole big drawer of glasses here and sunglasses. Two Nobel Prizes. And that also gets pinned in. Then, this wig is down here. That all gets pinned on. And also, his eyebrows. Oops, now we're inside. And all that gets pinned on and stabilized so it doesn't fall off. See, so the arms are like this so that they can be made to be live. And the camera cuts off right there, so it looks like he's got moving hands.
Technical term, we like to call it waiting around.
There my hands! There, how are you?
Hey! Hey, I had a drive from New Jersey. For the first time, I believe him. It's really an asshole.
He knows.
You
see, he thought he was moving to New Jersey. It said New Mexico.
What a drive. All night. All night.
Waiting for me.
3 days.
Give me your New Jersey then.
Come in and kind of look at the phone and wonder what it is.
Like a Martian. Au revoir, flying cars. Au revoir.
Au revoir.
And bring in the word across the top.
Oh! Oh!
Tell the
phone.
And you guys know how you're going to get out of
this? No, we did, forgot that part.
It's a fade.
A fade. Well, those are good.
He can't even do it right.
Action.
Okay, so let's suit up Carol and rehearse Oscar and the pull.
Well,
you yeah, just pull this up.
Button, red button.
We're in the lobby.
That's
the Cha-Cha Palace. Are you kidding me? I don't believe this.
What?
What is he said? The Cha-Cha Palace.
Off my toe.
Here we go. 5, 4, 3, chicken pot pie, action.
Oh,
God. I don't believe this.
I don't know if that's a funny thing. You can't get to the Cha-Cha Palace.
Oh, come on, how'd you tell them there's just two of us?
Well, seeing as how there's just,
let's see.
Stand by, please. Here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, action.
Hey, come on, Oscar.
Starts action, and you're watching the bird here, and he skates away from you. And camera two carries him down. So when he does that, three, and you get closer to him. Three will carry you, walking down to the bird. When you get here, he will take off in that direction. So camera two has got this. Camera three picks up the bird going back. Arnie, you'll have to be clear. Camera two picks up Madeline, carries her over.
Take it easy on this, Carol.
Boy, you are so talented.
Well, thanks, but aren't you tired of watching me?
I could do this all day.
Well, I'm a little tired of being watched myself. Why don't you watch some other birds for a while?
Other birds? Where?
Well, I'll show you. Hey, gang, come here. This is Gummo and Zeppo, Curly and Mo. We call them the Canary Brothers. Madeline, meet the Canary Brothers. Canary Brothers, meet Madeline.
I do. I'm very pleased to meet you.
Yeah, they can sing really good, too. They can sing like canaries.
Now, if Ernie's going to do the thing and they're sort of going to pop up...
I don't know. I like general, being around in the background.
Sort of milling around in the background.
I think bouncing in time
to the music. One we should
you guys could be, you know, doing the whole corny.
Yeah.
Throughout the whole thing. Keeping corny time.
Well done.
Corny time. Yeah.
But in the open space, in the middle, if everybody was sort of running around in front of it, I don't think we will. Up on the camera.
Really.
Yeah. You know, and you come, you know, fairly close. I would come about here somewhere. Yeah. You know? So it's almost like a nice solo. Everybody gets a nice solo. think? You're not farting.
John.
A little closer.
The thing that
see, go until you're, come yeah. See, one of our problems here is always headroom. See, all the empty space at the top. The guy in the foreground always has to
well,
blow his, the
his should
together.
Be pretty clean.
Okay.
Yeah.
11 o'clock at night.
Very hot.
Chris Sir says he didn't even realize this was a tongue twister.
I would cross my mental fingers as I went into that line every time I hit it. Singing about 11 o'clock at night.
Oh, no.
Maybe,
yes, this is
wonderful.
Yeah, you have merchandise.
His carrot, Bert.
Ernie.
Hey, Bert. I don't know if he'll get cold and lonely out here all by himself. Then he'll be sad. I don't want him to be sad.
He doesn't feel sad or lonely like we do, Ernie. He doesn't have feelings. He's made of snow. He can't get cold.
Snow's cold, Bert.
Ernie, he cannot feel anything. Not lonely or sad or cold. He can't even feel if somebody touches him.
Oh, we'll see about that, Bert. I'll tickle him. He'll feel that. Tickle, tickle, tickle. Now he needs a scarf. Bert, why don't you loan him your scarf? There, Bert. Hi. I feel much better now,
It'd
Bert.
Be nice if you pulled the scarf and just twirled Bert. Okay.
There. We do this with Mr. Puppets?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The only, if we need to do a stop for the scarf, it would be better if I get your, so that each time I can go to your I Don't Believe It. Before you complete, so I've got an edit. The first time when you takes the hat off of you, I cut to you for a big reaction.
Yeah.
And then so I've got an edit point if I need it.
Okay, but like if somebody could be here with a box or a ladder, and as soon as I've taken the hat off of Bert, person here grabs hat and puts on snow mask. There. How's that, Bert? That's all finished now, huh?
That's a terrific styrofoam snowman, yeah.
That's some snowman, yeah. Huh, Bert? I think it's one of the nicest snowmen I've seen in a long, long time.
In many
Bert.
Ages and moons.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go home, I'm hungry.
Hey, Bert.
I'll do that on the tight shot, huh? Or not? Should I wait for it? Okay, let's go home, I'm hungry.
Bert, wait a minute, Bert.
Hmm?
We can't just leave. I mean, what if our snowman here gets hungry or gets cold or hungry?
Ernie, he's made out of snow. See, where are you going? There's a difference.
I was getting in the tight shot, Bert.
There's a difference between things that are alive and things that aren't. See, we're alive. We eat, we breathe, we grow. The snowman doesn't do any of those things.
Yeah, but how do you know, Bert? I mean, he's got a mouth and he's got a nose.
Ernie, he's got a carrot that we put on him as a nose.
Well, maybe he breathes through his carrot, Bert.
Oh, Ernie.
Bert, I don't want him to get lonely or sad, Bert. Bert, I don't want him to be sad, Bert. I don't want this old man to be sad, Bert.
There goes to the end of the bit. Ernie.
There. Oh, his head looks so much warmer now, Bert. But I think he could use something like a scarf, Bert. Maybe you'd loan him your scarf.
Wah-ha-ha!
Here we go. Close encounters of the worst kinds. Trash can spacecraft. Oathmar of the Space Grouch is in it. Now, who's going to play Oathmar?
Brian.
Good. We'll have a tape stop at the bottom of page one, check, set the puppet. And let's really drop that can. I mean, from somewhere.
Can we do that? We can go in and run. What's it going to do to the studio floor, hitting it from you?
I don't know that why you're putting live plywood down there. Maybe. We'll get that.
Yeah, maybe we should do that. Piece of plywood to Kevin Landau. Right? Because it would look great coming down. It'll come through the shot shattered. It can be just sort of a grouchy looking space capsule that has handles on it like a trash can would have or something.
Oh, okay.
You know?
How wide is this going to be?
Wide enough for two puppeteers.
Then the thing we drop.
Has to be approximately that.
Represents, yeah. Right?
Okay, so then we stop tape and we put in the actual puppet stage trash can with the grouch in it, and he pops out, and it's Oathmar the space grouch. Who's going to do his helmet with the broken TV rabbit ears?
We will. I thought it was a regular grouch.
Regular grouch.
Yeah, regular grouch design. It'll be a color you've never seen before.
Now we're talking chroma key. It says, after one, smoke comes out from the bottom of the space can. It makes terrible clanking noises. Tape stop and slowly rises chroma key. Okay? Olivia watches in amazement, probably as our cutaway to get from the tape stop to the chroma key. And we see the thing go up and out, and she watches it, and it goes away up in the sky. And she says, now I've seen everything. Now we stop tape again there. Section B, we're now in the spacecraft.
And we're in the blue side.
And Oscar and Othmar are there, no chroma key or anything, it's just sky. And they talk, and Oscar says, there's the circle, we're gonna miss it. And they start arguing, no we're not, yes we are. Oscar says, give me the wheel. And the wheel should come out of the spacecraft here. Rip it out and give it to him. The Laurel and Hardy joke. Here, you want the wheel? Take it. You know? And says, you're really a rotten driver. And the other guy says, I thought you were driving. Those jokes, you know? And we'll do a few of those, like so. And he says, you're going to miss the circle. You're going to miss it. And build, 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 build. Cut. Cut section C. They're standing there. We drop the can yet again into the thing, like so.
Anything
to fall off? No. Nothing. I mean, anti-climax. If you want one little thing to fall off, a hubcap.
Maybe the antenna.
Yes.
The antenna will, right?
Yeah. All right, that's the end of that little thing.
Yeah! Oh, what about Uncle Wiggly's?
Super pigtails. What's your voice?
I don't know. Probably just a mean, nasty, low grouch. Try not to do Oscar or Telly. Or
it's gonna be tough.
Chuck, I need as much profile as you can give me. That's about it. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. All right, now guys, wait a minute, Ron, don't get in there yet.
We had more than that last
I want to turn it so that yeah, is upstage that way.
Stand by. Here we go.
You're looking at camera two and you're close up. When you get your action cue, just turn from camera two back to look up at the sky again.
Stand. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, action.
Widen from the two shot to let the cast come in probably here. So if you get that monitor out of there and they'll come into this little area here.
Okay.
Don't do, hey, what's going on until the camera starts to shake. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'll add a sound effect. So it's drifting in outer space, weightless. Then the camera will go buckety buckety, and then you start the dial to what's going on. There is trash in outer space. And then the camera will settle down so I can dissolve without the thing going buckety buckety. All right?
At first, working with puppets was very strange. It took a lot of concentration for me not to look at the puppeteer. You know, I did my test for Gordon with Carol Spinney as Oscar, and I kept looking at Carol, And it really took a while to get used to looking at Oscar. But after you know, a while, you develop, I guess, a facility at relating to the puppet. Yeah. And it's amazing how each of the characters take on a very strong identity and character and personality of their own, so that you really do begin to relate to each of those characters. I've worked with Grover a few times, and I really like the kind of offbeat humor. You know, it's kind of a... And working with Frank Oz also tends to be very exciting, because he's so unpredictable. He's very good at ad-lib.
I had started about 10 years before Sesame Street on local television in Washington, D.C., and I was doing a late-night show. It was a five-minute show that was on at 11:30 at night. And so most of our work was sort of sophisticated, and it had a slight black humor kind of quality, and our audience was really college. And so when we did Sesame Street, that was the first time we'd ever worked for children, really, specifically for children. And so it was an interesting and a different kind of thing for us. I remember when first bringing in a sketch of Big Bird, because I had in mind that we would do this large, silly character who would be oversized, you know, a great big character, and would represent the child, you know, so that the character would make all the silly mistakes that children make, and yet a kid could look at it, you know, from a different perspective, and therefore learn about himself. So that was the idea. And so I'm sure that at that time we were thinking that he would be interacting with live people and so forth. But I remember at the same time, I remember presenting sketches for Big Bird and for Oscar, who at that time I'd planned to have him magenta. He was going to be magenta colored. And the early cameras were not good enough to record that color. And so we had to change the color just because it wouldn't work. The very first one we used on the street was orange in color, and we used that for a year. And I didn't like that either, so we changed to the present color of green. Well, characters have come about from many different ways. Some of the characters were puppets that we had before Sesame Street, and they became personalities. You know, they took on a personality. Cookie Monster certainly was that. We had used Cookie Monster before in the Ed Sullivan Show. We were doing sketches on the Ed Sullivan Show, and he was this monster that ate a computer, for instance, and so we used, and then when he became part of Sesame Street, he became a monster. And then there was a sketch that in which it was another monster, actually, who ate the cookie, who got a cookie as a reward for a game show. And then that became a Cookie Monster, but then it wasn't our Cookie Monster, who sort of evolved into that. So Cookie Monster evolved, and a great deal of that was through Frank. You know, Frank has taken each of his characters, and they have grown a great deal and changed as he's worked with them. Sometimes a character is designed for the show, in which some of the time in the early days I would do designs or sketches for some of those first ones. Other characters in our present form, we work with the Anything Muppets. Those are the blank heads, and we change the faces on them. And we created somebody like the Count was created just by putting features on one of our Anything Muppets. Carol Spinney was one of our early performers on Sesame Street. And actually, he was one of the few that had not worked with us before. And I met him at a puppet festival. And I remember asking if he would like to come and join us. And I described this very large yellow bird. And I think, I'm sure he had no idea what he was in for when he agreed to come and work this character. Other performers with us from the beginning, Jerry Nelson. Jerry does wonderful voices, and in all of our different productions, Jerry's responsible for some of the best singing, and of course he does the Count on the show, and numerous other characters. Richard Hunt was just a kid when he first started working with us, and he's still a kid now, but he's one of the delightful people. I think his exuberant personality lends a great deal to you know, this quality of what the Muppets are. Performing the Ernie and Bert pieces with Frank has always been one of the great joys of doing this show. And it's really a unique way of working in television, because most of the time you're in television, you're taking a script and you're doing the lines. But about half the time when Frank and I are working, we decide not to use the script. Instead, we'll take the basic concepts of it, and if it has a punchline or two, we'll circle around and hit those lines. But other than that, we'll just talk the piece. And so we're really working spontaneously and just sort of playing off of each other, and it's a lot of fun. You see, puppetry is a very limited form. There are so many things that you cannot do. And so it's sort of like a game that we're playing with the audience, because there are only certain kinds of things that we can do well with the puppets. You know, you basically don't see them below the waist. And also there's this very large puppeteer that's sort of right there beneath the puppet. And so what we try to do is we try to shoot them in such a way that it feels like that they're able to do everything that people do, and that they're moving around in a set in the same way that people do. So it's kind of a game, you know, where we only have a limited range of things that we can do, and we try to fake the rest into the audience, you know, feeling that these things are totally dimensional. But we had started, when I began working on television, I started working with a television monitor, and I'm sure I wasn't the first person to do that. Bill Baird and Bert Tilstrom were both working on television before I was. But using the television monitor, we, the performer, take our whole performance from the monitor. And so this is kind of a unique thing in that you can perform and see your performance exactly as the audience does. This is unique in the performance field. I mean, no other actor can ever see their performance at the same time they're doing it. And so as we're performing, we're also editing. You know, we're kind of editing ourselves, we're framing the shots. And so these are the kinds of techniques that we had developed before we came to Sesame Street. I've always loved this show. I've loved being a part of it from the very beginning. And it was something that during the 70s, I suppose, the whole country felt it was slightly in a depression, you know, and emotional type of depression. And when you were working for the preschool kids, like the fives, four, five, six-year-olds, you can't be depressed about that. I mean, you know, this is such a wonderful age, and it's this wonderful innocence that you're dealing with. So I loved doing all of that for all of those years, and I still love it, and I feel it's still a very important show, and I will continue to be part of it as long as it's going and as long as they want me. I think that television is such a huge influence on children. I think it's the next most important influence to the family or the church or the school and television. And as an industry, we don't generally face up to that responsibility. And I think we need to be a great deal more responsible to what we put on the medium. And I think a show like Sesame Street is correct. I mean, I'm delighted to be doing that sort of thing. We should do much more of that.
We had an ensemble of a lot of different monsters, colorful monsters and everything. And so the shop decided to make a red one. They had Oscar and they had, you know, Cookie Monster and, you know, and they had all these different monsters, but they said it'd be nice to do it. So they just designed, they drew, you know, and built it, and it became like for production numbers. We used to do a lot of production numbers with Muppets back then. And so he was just built as a red monster. And so what happened is, you know, anybody who was in the insert would pick him up, you know. But David Kaur, who was one of the writers at the time, really, really liked the character, really liked the way the puppet looked. So in his scripts, he would write about this little character, and the producer was like, who is this? And they said, well, he said, I'd love to use the red, you know, this little red monster. Back then, Brian Meehl, who was one of the puppeteers, very, very talented guy, he actually originated Barkley and Telly Monster on the show. Very funny actor and stuff like that. He left, he was doing, actually he did Barkley, he did Telly, he performed a character by the name of Nobel Price. Alphabet Bates was another character that he did a bunch of characters. And he took on, he was the first one to perform Elmo, and he had this little whispery voice, it was really sweet. But then he left the show and started his, you know, pursuing his acting and writing career. And he left, and so now everybody had to, the puppeteers that were there had to take over for his character. So as you well know, Marty Robinson took over Telly, and Barkley was taken over by another puppeteer. Nobel, I actually took, Richard Hunt, who is one of the most celebrated of the main Muppeteers with Jim and Frank and Jerry. He was one of the other main Muppeteers with Jim And he took it over. And it wasn't his type of character. He started yelling. He was like, yes, Elmo do this, Elmo do that. And Norman Styles, who was the head writer at the time, really hated what he was doing. He would call up Lisa Simon, the producer, and say, listen, can you get him to stop screaming? You know, this is not working, blah, blah, blah. So I was one of the Muppeteers. I was the only Muppeteer that was in the lounge that we had at the time. And Richard came in with the puppet, and he said, you know, he threw it to me, and he said, come up with a voice. And I did the falsetto voice. He said, okay, fine. He took me to the control room where Lisa was and said, listen, you know, I don't need to do this puppet. Apparently, I'm not doing it right because Norman's calling over saying I'm not, you know, and I don't, Kevin has a voice for it. I'm going to give it to him. Is that okay? She said, I don't care. And so that's how I got, you know, to perform Elmo. I think we had like two or three more shows and the season was going to be over, and one of them had Elmo in it. And I didn't know what to do. I felt as though Richard couldn't do anything. What was I going to do with it? I got through that season, and then I went home and hung out with my mother and their daycare kids again. And, you know, observed them and to see what I could bring to Elmo. And this little character, this little kid, Ryan, who was really, really funny. He was the type of kid that, you know, one time he'd be crying like bloody murder. Somebody, you know, did something to him. Next, in a second, he'd be laughing about something. So I love that kind of thing that the kids, you know, it's just wait a minute and they'll change their personality. But also I thought about, you know, I watched a lot of Muppet stuff and I thought about the Muppet edge that Jim and Frank gave the characters and tried to figure that out. So the next season I came in, I did a little piece with Emilio Delgado, who plays Luis, at the Fix-It Shop. And it was Elmo going on an imaginary vacation, and he was packing, you know, imaginary clothes in a suitcase, and I figured it all out. And lo and behold, one of the camera guys, it was Frankie, who started laughing. And the first, you know, time you get a laugh, you think you're doing something. So, you know, that gave me the confidence to keep going. You know, then they took it out to research, and research saw that Elmo was working. The kids not only were laughing at him, but they were also learning what they were supposed to learn. And so they kept writing for him, and, you know, now he's this, you know, big, big celebrity now.
1, 2, 3.
You really taped that?
Yeah, we did.
Look at she says.
That's pretty good. That's pretty funny.
Let's look at it back.
My name is Leslie Carrara Rudolph. I am a puppeteer and my co-pilot. Yes, I'm her co-pilot for Joy, of Abby Cadabby and other different various monsters, old ladies and dudes and stuff or whatever. And I've been on Sesame Street this since Abby's been here, so this will be fourth season. Yeah, so a little over 3 or 4 years. Sesame Street just has been part of my life the whole time, and I think it's one of those things that bonds people together. And when I was in Los Angeles and I found out I got the job, I was taking my puppet Lolly, which is a soft puppet, to this actor's lounge and doing crazy stuff. And it's all different races and ages and everything. It's an actor's workout and all different ages. And they came out and they said, we have an announcement today. Leslie's made Sesame Street. And everybody just like, whoa! You know, and we all started crying. It was just like, you made Sesame Street. My friend goes, you made Fairy, you know? So I think it's that something that bonds people to a memory where they are, everybody's young at heart. So I think that was when it dawned on me, like, wow, it is. It's like the Olympics of children's television and something that you can always count on because it set the bar.
The process for developing any character for Sesame Street is going to be different depending upon the character. And one of the most intricate and involved processes was actually the character of Abby. So we started with some conceptual drawings of what we thought this fairy character might be. We went through several rounds of that, and then further design work was passed on to a Sesame Workshop designer who started with our ideas and developed them a little further. And then once that had been approved on paper, then our puppet designer, Raleigh Crewson, started building mock-ups of the character. This isn't all the things we considered, but these were some of them. This is a long-haired sheepskin, and then this is a short fake fur that we've used on many of our smaller characters, but we had established that it looked too much like the fur that we had used, and we were trying to come up with that something different, you know, not fleece, not fur. We've used ostrich feathers often in hair. It gives such great movement, so we often put that in the fur. And so we did indeed use that. The pom-poms on her head are mostly made out of ostrich. This is the beautiful puppet that Raleigh Crewson made for us. This shows the finished dress, diaphanous dress of many colors. Very subtle painting on the wings. All of the colors and textures in her hair. Notice the almond-shaped eyes that we have come to a slight point near the nose. And one of the other things that we had to work out in the build of this puppet is the movement of the wings, because the options for us would be to operate them, connect with rods, arm rods, have second puppeteer behind that actually manually moves the wings, but we weren't getting a good flutter that way. So we did another where it is manipulated with a mech that has a trigger down here and has that flap. We also have a radio controlled Abby. Her wings are on a radio controlled movement so that from a distance they can be operated by another puppeteer. And this way we can either have Leslie Carrara operate the wings, or she can have another puppeteer behind if she needs to use both hands. Currently she's not holding her wand. She usually has that with her. But Raleigh did a beautiful job of giving her so much movement, so much emotion, mm-hmm. so much expression in this very tiny face.
Piece, you're gonna do to Sean, but then we're gonna jump onto Frankie. One of you pops up, the other one pops up, the other one pops up, and then you're gonna pop out of that shot and come back in when the lights change.
There's summer, winter,
fall and spring. It's the seasons while we sing.
That's great. Quiet, please. 3, 2, 1, track.
Hey everybody, let's play Guess the Season!
Do you know the seasons? Summer, fall, winter, spring!
We will give you the clues and you guess the season!
Let's do it, girls!
Awake and fall and winter, fall and spring, and round the seasons we know. There's summer, winter, fall and spring. Guess the season while we
okay,
sing.
Okay.
I'd say
do whatever works. If you need to be closer so that she can play with you, but I love that
idea
of
playing
with the back. No, I can actually go back there because I have my shoes off now.
Okay, great.
Okay.
All right, let's try another rehearsal.
Here we go. Standing by. So, guys, this is your Y. Here we go. In 3, 2, 1, track.
Oh.
Just take
close to 50 years now, I've played a character who's 6 years old. In less than 2 years, I'll reach the big 8-0. Makes me America's oldest child star.
Brilliant. Hello, Big Bird.
Oh, hi, Gordon.
How are you?
The beginning was that Jim Henson felt that Big Bird should be a country yokel and a little slow.
Meet Sally.
Oh, sure. Oh, hi, Sally. Hi, Sally? Where's Sally?
Big Bird, look down, look down, look down, this way.
I don't see her.
The scene came along that seemed as though he should be a child. And I said, I think that I should play him as a child from here on.
Boy, I nearly laid an egg right here on Sesame Street.
So within a matter of days, his voice went from, well, here I am, well, here I am, here I am now. And so that's where the bird came from.
Tag! That was it!
Being an actor on Sesame Street, one who acts at the end of my arm, is sort of wonderful to play. Children are relating as though Big Bird is one of their friends. And that is what I think has endeared this Sesame Street so much.
Hi, kids. I'm Big Bird. What's your name?
We get to be the friends of those who watch. Big Bird has always had some obstacles you had to overcome physically. In the scene in the Bird Watchers, when he gets to the woods, he has to climb a little ladder to get up. I really can't see out of the bird, and I'm not claustrophobic, which is very helpful with this. And I do have a tiny television monitor, but it only shows me what you'd see as you're watching.
I'm not sure these branches will hold me.
My right hand is busy in holding Big Bird's head. With my left, I'm free to use it. It's the left wing. And I had gotten quite used to playing Big Bird where I can't see. Yeah. Or I can't find the prop. Sometimes we have to stop because I reach for something and it's here. Yeah, and there's no depth perception right in those things.
Right there, okay.
There's a thing in puppetry. If you're comfortable, you're probably doing it wrong.
Rusty, what do you think? You want to be friends?
There's a scene in the camping show. You'll notice that Big Bird is not really sitting in the seat because he would tower over the little puppet. And so I'm really probably on my knees on the floor, whereas the puppeteer holding the little guy is laying with his feet probably under the other seats. And being a puppeteer is to act and hide. And in order to do that, you often have to be extremely in awkward positions. I was watching the part where I'm up on a ledge. Gee, that looks precarious. If I do have a complex move to make, there's a couple of feathers right near where my eye is inside the neck. A couple of feathers are on Velcro, and I have a little tiny hole, generally about a quarter inch by a quarter inch, just enough to see the door jamb or someplace to orient myself for a striding in. Because normally I'm working looking down at my little monitor strapped to my chest. So it appears that if I walk left, I'm actually going right in your picture because you're looking for the other side. Even now, after all these years, I have to kind of make a little orientation in my scene to rock him a little bit, say, okay, I'm going to have to walk that way because I'm watching this picture. I'm relating to the opposite where I am. So it's always a little bit rubbing your head and patting your stomach. See, I can't even do that now.
Whew, a bird that roller skates. Boy, you sure are talented.
The episode about the bird watchers is quite funny. Madeline Kahn, who was a wonderful actress, she's a very shy person.
Whoa.
But once she has the character, she's all out there.
Very, very Big Bird.
I worked with her on stage one time. It was a live show, which fortunately Jim Henson was in the audience. He didn't see me work very much. I wanted to know that I was holding my own. And Big Bird and she, in the song, get into a contest about who can jazz it up the most.
I can sing.
You can?
Yeah.
Jim came back after us and slapped me on the back and says, that was great. Well, that made you feel good because anytime Jim Henson was around, everyone was in awe.
I've just spotted a parrot in the fix-it shop.
The male there is puppeteer Richard Hunt. And I didn't remember that our good friend Richard was playing a character because he was a puppeteer.
Oh, at last!
Shh, this is wonderful.
But he was a very funny puppeteer.
It talks.
Doesn't everyone?
Go, Mark, go!
I think that working with Mr. Snuffleupagus is, it's kind of really good because we both are Muppets with feet. Jim would put me in lots of scenes with, when I worked on his shows, dancing scenes. And unfortunately, I cannot learn dance steps. So I said, why do you always put me in dance scenes? I'm a terrible dancer. And he said, you're the only Muppet with feet. Big Bird and Snuffy have been great friends for years. And they were great friends before anybody believed in him. And it was, there was years of confusion about Big Bird and Snuffy because everyone assumed that he was imaginary, but he was real all the time. He tells every, keeps telling people all the fun things he'd been doing with Snuffy.
Well, I was playing a little guessing game with my friend, Mr. Snuffleupagus.
And they just say, Big Bird, we're kind of tired of hearing your imaginary friend. He's not real.
Big Bird, come on.
And so Big Bird goes to see Snuff, and he said, Bird, why are you looking so sad? Well, Snuffy, the grown-ups know more than I do, and they all know you're not real, and so I really can't be friends with you. You're not real, so this is goodbye. And he said, oh, Bird, this is very sad. And so he said, well, can you at least give me a hug goodbye? And Big Bird and Snuffy are natural huggers because my wing fits right around Snuffy's big snuffle. He hugs and he says, oh, Snuffy, your tears are getting my feathers all wet.
They're getting all wet, Snuffy, and wait a minute. If my feathers are getting wet, that means your tears are real and that you're real. Snuffy, you are real. I'm never going to say goodbye to you. I love you, you know. Take care.
I love you too, Bird.
Hey, Carol, action.
Oh, you're here. Well, since you're here, I might as well answer a set of questions which have been submitted to me here at the old trash can.
I also play Oscar.
Oscar, this is the most exciting thing that ever happened on Sesame Street.
You call this exciting? I call it yucky.
Oscar's an exercise of being, so some people he's cool, although obnoxious can be cool, I guess. I don't know if he's that obnoxious, it may not be the right word, but he is definitely irritable. But I was the least cool kid in school. I had puppets, I had the name Carol, and I was the shortest boy in class.
Hey, Gordon, here's some water for you.
Oh, Oscar, that's terrible!
I try not to have Oscar be mean, because irritable doesn't necessarily mean, although I think Oscar's been a little bit rude because he calls Gordon with a shaved head curly.
Gosh, Oscar, you know deep down, you're really a nice person.
I am not.
I really love being the Bird because I think he's good and represents goodness. And it's fun to play Oscar. I know what he thinks like because it's exactly opposite of how I feel you should be or talk to people.
Could I comment on Carol Spinney? Well, I'd rather not say anything about that turkey.
I just drew pictures of all of my grown-up friends on Sesame Street, and I'm going to give them to you.
I've always felt that it was probably one of the finest bit of writing we've ever had. We've had a lot of great writing, but it was so sensitive a subject. It was the death of Mr. Hooper.
Can I see that? Nice.
Oh, that's really terrific. Good.
Will became a great friend to all of us, and so when he passed, we were heartbroken.
Where is he? I want to give it to him. I know. He's in the store.
A Big Bird? Mm-hmm. He's not in there.
Big Bird, when people die, they don't come back.
Ever?
No, never.
At the end of the scene, most all our faces, including my own, were covered with tears. The man who played Mr. Hooper had died.
You know, I'm gonna miss you, Mr. Looper.
That's Hooper, Big Bird, Hooper.
Bob McGrath is in that in the death scene.
Oh, that's really terrific.
Good.
Really looks like it.
He was the first actor I got to know when I came to the show. The show was fledgling. I sat with him and talked, and we didn't, neither of us knew what the show was going to be like or what it was going to look like or anything. It was going to be on a street. We knew the name. Other than that, we knew nothing. And I soon learned that Bob is the real thing. He's just a really great, fine guy.
You're right, Big Bird. It'll never be the same around here without him. Mm. But you know something? We can all be very happy that we had a chance to be with him and to know him,
yeah,
and to love him a lot when he was here.
Yeah.
James Earl Jones told me that he wouldn't be an actor today if it hadn't been for Will Lee, who played Mr. Hooper. James was a stutterer and was too shy to think of going on and be a serious actor. And he told me that if it wasn't for Will, he wouldn't, he had to said, but you've noticed, you have to get confidence in yourself. You don't stutter when you know your lines. You've never stuttered a single line on that stage. And so you have it. You're going to have a good career. And I hadn't known that because I'd worked with James Earl Jones 3 times. It was the 3rd time he told me that after Will had passed.
Aww. Give us a hug, Big Bird.
Oh, good.
Because we're going to miss you.
Oh, Big Bird. Enjoy yourself. Enjoy
Will Lee was such a great guy. And I could tell the last day I happened to be just a few days before Thanksgiving. And we were shooting our last scene for the day and for the season. And I put my arm around Will's shoulder and I said, I love you, Mr. Looper. And he said, I love you, Carol. And those were our last words. 2 days later, he marched in the Thanksgiving parade for the Macy's parade. And on Saturday, he died.
There's Louise and Mr. Looper.
Hoopa, Big Bird, hoopa, hoopa.
We'd like you to stay and chat.
But I have got no time for that. David, Telly, and Olivia.
Hi, goodbye.
I gotta leave ya.
Simply gotta run, you know.
And Oscar's glad to see him go.
See him go.
See him go.
See him go.
Yeah, I'm going to camp.
He's going to camp.
And my joy is overflowing. Going to camp.
He's going to camp.
Who did you say was going?
Big Bird is going, going,
going,
going, going, going.
I love Big Bird as though he was my son, a kid. I don't feel that I am Big Bird. I get to, when they say action, his life begins again.
I don't believe he's going.
Yes, he's really, really going.
Going,
going, going, going,
going,
going,
going.
Nice to meet you.
Surprise. Yes.
Heard a lot about
him.
Yeah, quite good.
Oh, good. We're all waiting to see your new invention, Dr. Price.
Wait no more, world.
Like so. That's a real delay, isn't it?
And then you just throw it down into your other hand.
Right.
Okay, but I gotta cut you off so I can see the umbrella. I mean,
so
on an angle instead of horizontal.
We know because we can't lift one arm higher than the other.
That's the best I can give you, is right there.
That's the best we're gonna do.
You hold this little metal point right here, yeah. Then you open it.
Yes.
Yes.
We can do it, you can too, to grow up strong and healthy. Exercise gives you energy. Just look at Betty Lou.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's all exercise.
Exercise!
It's fun to exercise. Let's get into exercise. We get stronger working out.
Woo!
Working out. We get stronger. Let's all exercise.
Exercise!
It's fun to exercise. Let's get into exercise. We get stronger working out. Working out. We we get stronger. Let's all exercise.
Exercise.
It's fun to exercise. Let's get into exercise. We get stronger working out. Working out. We get stronger.
Stand by. Here we go. Very quiet.
Welcome to La Casa de Comidas. That means the House of Foods in Spanish.
Very nice.
Muy bueno. Actually, I am not a Spanish person myself, but I have learned a lot of Spanish words from my good friend Luis. I am Grover, your favorite singing and dancing waiter.
I recognized you.
How pleased I am. Good. What would you like to eat tonight? We have four specials. The numero uno, numero dos, the
Yes,
All right, Dick.
Yes.
In the middle of his line, there is an additional breed. Sorry, friend, this one's taken.
Yeah, I can see him. Ah, oh, there's my cousin Dulcie. Oh, there's Uncle Ralph. He's such a mensch. But where's the people?
How would you like to build your nest inside this beauty?
All right, edit. All right. May I try that once, if you just mark it for me, and I will now do it from inside with the cameras. And then if everything seems comfortable, we'll commit it to videotape. Yeah.
Golly wally. So, this is where us rare birds live, huh?
Yes. This is your new home in the country.
Mm.
Oh, listen, and you'll be very safe here. And you'll have lots of company. As you can hear, there are plenty of birds around.
Yeah, I can see them. Oh, look. There's my cousin Dulcie.
Really?
Yeah, and Uncle Ralph.
Oh.
Hmm.
See?
See.
Richard came in this morning. He's very concerned about what kind of character he's going to play.
Oh.
So we'll play with that a little bit.
Yes, okay.
You should sort of bounce off what you're doing.
Yeah. I'm playing the boss around a little bit.
Good.
Because she's a little boss.
Yes.
Everything under control.
We'll use that close-up again. Why do you need a ladder? Then back, Frankie.
What?
Okay. I'll take you over there.
Now, fake the whispering a little bit so that I get enough to pick up. I tell you what, call the single on this for that line. I'll take you over there.
I'll take you over there.
Now, do a little take into this camera and then down, and that'll be our edit. Then we'll pick you up coming out around the corner here. Okay? Just going. That'll be after the edit. Take two.
Say, Big Bird, somebody wants to take your...
Wait a minute. I got a better idea.
Sure.
Oh, yeah, it's wonderful. Maybe if we crept out there, very quiet. By this time, you just lost patience, you know? It's just, hey, I could save you a lot of time. Big Bird, somebody wants to take your picture.
Oh.
Right? Okay?
I can save you a lot of time. Excuse me. Say, Big Bird, somebody wants to take your picture.
Okay. Music is playing. You won't hear the music now. Music starts action, and you're watching the bird here. He skates away from you. And camera two carries him down.
No,
I got to help it. So when he does that, and you get closer to him. Three will carry you, walking down to the bird. When you get here, he will take off in that direction. So camera two has got this. Camera three picks up the bird going back. Arnie, you'll have to be clear. Camera two picks up Madeline, carries her
over.
Take it easy on this, Carol.
Boy, you are so talented.
Well, thanks, but aren't you tired of watching me?
I could do this all day.
Well, I'm a little tired of being watched myself. Why don't you watch some other birds for a while?
Other birds? Where?
Well, I'll show you. Hey, gang, come here. This is Gummo and Zeppo, Curly and Mo. We call them the Canary Brothers. Madeline, meet the Canary Brothers. Canary Brothers, meet Madeline.
I do. I'm very pleased to meet you.
Yeah, they can sing really good, too. They can sing like canaries.
I decided that when television came around, I would like to get into television as a puppeteer. And I did. Only 8 years after television began, I had my own puppet show called The Rascal Rabbit Show in Las Vegas, paid $10 a week. And I knew it was just a beginning. I think it was probably a terrible show. I didn't even have a monitor. I couldn't see what I was doing. So eventually, I kept doing puppets, and I got, that was in 55. I was in the military, got shipped out, so I lost that show. And in 60, I got back into TV in Boston. Jim Henson, who was scouting for somebody to play Big Bird and Oscar, he saw me doing my show, came backstage and said, would you like to join me? I thought that was sort of like, no, I knew who Jim Henson was. The Muppets weren't as big by any means at that time, but I saw them a lot on Ed Sullivan and other shows. And so it was though if I was a drummer, some fellow came along and said, I got a little band from Liverpool. Would you like to be me drummer then? You know, because to me, if there's a Beatles in the puppet world, it was the Muppets. Jim Henson was very humble himself, very interested in other people. And I never saw him angry. I'd see him upset, but he never reacted against anyone. And one day, when I in the early days of the show, I wasn't as disciplined as he and Frank Oz were doing, and we were doing the first scenes of Sesame Street. Little scenes where with the Anything Muppets, where they could put different eyes and different wigs, make them a little kid or a dragon. And I kept missing the opening note with the lip sync. And I'd miss, they'd say, so everyone likes ice cream. You know, it's one of my problems with puppetry. And so we were watching playbacks, and the third time I had still done it wrong. I missed that note. And Jim, a lot of people crowded around one of the monitors to watch the playback. And so he saw an empty one over on the other side. He walked over so he could look at that by himself, and he didn't see me walk up behind him. And I heard him quietly say, garbage, garbage.
And it went like a knife through me. I said, oh, God. I said, Jim, I'm sorry. I'm going to resign. I'm not good enough to be a Muppeteer. And he turned around and turned beat right. He said, oh, I wasn't talking about you. He lied. He said, my work isn't up to snuff today. I didn't think I was doing a very good job. And if you're having trouble with that thing, listen, there's a little tiny bell. If you hear that bell, just open the mouth and it will be just right. When we started, you know, Jim told me he wanted me to play two characters. One, he described the bird, and the bird initially was going to be just a silly, goofy bird. And the other was Oscar the Grouch. Didn't know what I was going to use for the voice, and it was getting down to the nitty-gritty.
Yes, I have a question.
What is it, Oscar?
What is the capital of South Dakota?
I had to go across town in a cab. So I hailed a cab and got in. The guy says, where to, Mac? And so I said, wow, what a great voice. And he had a cigar on one side of his mouth and a voice came out the other like this. And I said, that's perfect. So when I got out of the cab, I kept saying, where to, Mac? Where to, Mac? Because I'm trying to learn to do this voice, but I could imitate that very well. He really sounded a lot like that. I had never tried that. I swear if I hadn't looked at him, seeing him talk out of the corner of his mouth in his rearview mirror, because I'm sitting over there. And so I got Oscar's voice that way.
Goodbye, Oscar.
What? That's the nicest thing you've ever said to me.
When I do Big Bird, it's a lot of fun. And Oscar is too, because it's a totally different experience. After often doing the bird all day long, I'll know I've got a few more scenes at the end in there with Oscar. And it's almost therapeutic, because I've been sweet and nice all day, and now Oscar, yes, can be one of the most negative, cantankerous characters on television, even though he's on a children's show. And so it's a lot of fun. I never played a character like that. I call him my, if you remember Happy Days, and you remember the Fonz. Well, Oscar's my Fonz. He's cool.
Hey, you and me, Skinny.
The one great thing about television is that we don't look at the puppet. We're looking down at the monitor while we are manipulating the puppet. Everyone has only one eye. It's the camera's lens. If I turn him this way, his mouth looks like he's very sad, and I lower his eyes, and he can look very unhappy. Or if you tip him forward, his mouth goes up. It really doesn't, it's a stiff mouth. It doesn't change like a porpoise. He can't change his expression. Porpoises always look like they're rather pleased. But by aiming at them at the camera in this way or that, the puppeteer learns to study the expressions that go along with the emotions that we're portraying.
Never knew water came out of the ground.
One time I got a lovely letter from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. Don't you love to say that? And it was from a woman who had a little four-year-old boy named Christopher. And she heard sniffling. Big Bird was in a scene where he was the only child around. And so he was very, very sorry for himself because all the kids had gone off to school and he was too young. And so she hears Christopher watching the show, and she was busy in the kitchen, and she hears a little sniffling and crying, and she goes, what's wrong, Christopher? He said, Big Bird is just like me. He's all alone all day because the kids, his older brothers and sisters, were off to school. And so he saw himself and actually identified with Big Bird, who was, you know, hardly an ordinary-looking child. The bird became, as I said earlier, he was... Bird was really a goofy guy. When I decided he should be a child, and the producers thought that was a good idea as well, I started going higher with his voice. It's like, hi there.
Hi there, hi there. Until I got up here and tried to be a kid. Let's see. It says, welcome to Toadstool, the Mushroom City. The Mushroom City? Annual Tournament of Mushrooms Parade.
It was really fun to sit in a theater and hear the children react to the movie I had made, I must say. And one of the scenes, Big Bird gets kidnapped by some unscrupulous carnival guys, and they paint him blue. and when it affected children more than I knew when we filmed it, that the whole theater was hearing, because they were all crying.
He must be real. He's crying. What's the matter?
I'm in big trouble, see? Could you do me a favor? I can't get out of here, and I want to. So could you call Mr. Looper's store on Sesame Street?
We used to be able to tape two whole shows every day, one in the morning and one in the afternoon. And we take longer now because we have much more special effects and a lot more competition. But when we made the movie, it was slow motion. Often it would take an hour and a half, 2 hours for them to put the new tracks down for a trucking shot. And so I did spend a lot of time reading the magazines, sitting in the Winnebago, a lot of waiting. And one call one day, I was called at 1 p.m. and I had to wait so long. We filmed it at 6 a.m. following morning. And there was no sleep that night.
Why? It's Miss Finch!
Oh!
What'll I do?
Hide
where?
The hayfield!
Yes!
Run!
Wait!
Bye!
Oh dear! Oh!
We're now taping our 40th year of the show and celebrating the 25th anniversary of this nice movie, Follow That Bird. So I hope you enjoy the movie and have fun.
Wait, don't leave yet. My favorite part of the picture is starting the credits. Oh, I love to count credits. Ha, ha, ha.